Did you know that 90% of a child's brain develops in the first 3 years? Developing innovative ways to educate is a key ingredient in the process.
Have fun with the kids and make them forget that they're learning.
We'll also hear about the big picture perspective concerning childhood education here in Central Florida. Two Central Floridians talk about the importance of early childhood education. Next on Metro Center Outlook. Hello, I'm Diane Trees. Nationally, we will spend almost $600 billion on public education this year. It's of the utmost importance that we spend that money wisely. Joining us now is Jennifer Pena, also known as Miss Rosa. For years, she's been a fixture in the PBS Early Education Program. Jennifer, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
You grew up in Florida. You are an FSU graduate. Can you share what it meant to your family? You are a college graduate, I believe the first in your family to.
I was. I grew up in a household where my father dropped out of school in probably the equivalent of seventh or eighth grade. And my mother graduated from high school and did a few classes at the community college level, but nothing really major. It was something that was, you know, the local community college, driving distance, nothing major. And so my siblings and I grew up with it being reinforced at the importance of education. My dad used to tell us that education is the key that opens the door to whatever you want. And that's the mentality that I always had. So for myself, it was a no-brainer that I was going to go to college. But I never had the opportunity to have a campus nearby that I could go and experience and be on the actual campus and gain a sense of what it was to be on campus. The first time that I stepped foot on FSU's campus was for freshman orientation. So I never did the college travels or the trips or the visits, which now thinking back, it's like,
you're very brave.
My parents let me move 4 hours away.
They must have been thrilled though.
They were so excited. They were so impressed. But what really impressed them was that I did this all of myself. My mother didn't know what it was to fill out college application forms or what it was to study for the SATs and ACTs. And so they really had total faith in me. And I showed them that I had the ability and the responsibility level to do it myself. And so I think that's kind of what showed them that I was ready.
Well, it sounds like they had already developed that concept for you, that education was the key, and then you took it from there. Now, you are an advocate for children's programming. You've also stressed how critical it is for parents to be watching with their children as well. Why the combination of the two?
Yes, co-viewing is so important. There's nothing better, now that I'm a mother of two young children, there's nothing better than having your child come up and say something to you or make a reference to something from a show that they've watched, and you know as a parent exactly what they're talking about because you saw it too, or you heard it in the background, and you can make that connection with your child instead of, honey, I don't know what you mean.
Or a dinosaur or whatever.
Exactly, exactly. You know, a great example that I always give is my son and I, who's now three, watched an episode of Curious George, and it was an episode where George finds a caterpillar. And so he's feeding the caterpillar and taking care of the caterpillar, and the caterpillar goes into the chrysalis. And he's like, oh, he's got his own sleeping bag. And then it becomes the butterfly. And so the following day or 2 days later, we're outside, and I saw a caterpillar on a leaf on one of the plants outside. I called my son over. I said, honey, look, it's a caterpillar. And his eyes lit up, and he said, Mama, it's just like Curious George. And that's what it's all about. It's making that full circle, giving a chance to children to see something and learn something new on television, but then being able to take that outside of the television and put it in their own world. That gets them excited about learning. That makes them want to learn more. And that's what PBS is all about. That's why we trust our kids with PBS.
Well, and you were talking about being able to identify that with your son. Is there any other suggestions you have for parents that might reinforce that positive learning, what the children are watching on PBS Kids shows?
Absolutely. Take some of the shows that you're watching with your kids, be it Curious George or Super Wire, The Cat in the Hat, and use them as examples that you can do in your own house. One of the things that I do when I have my live performances is a dance freeze game. What kid doesn't like to dance? And it's something that we can all do with our kids, right?
Possibly, if you're coordinated.
Well, even if you can't, you still look good in the eyes of a 3-year-old or 5-year-old. So it doesn't matter. You throw on some music and you say, if I say a color, then you freeze. But if I say a different word, then you dance. And so that's something that anybody can do in their
Simple
house.
Simple things like
Simple
that.
Simple things. When you're in the car, have the kids look for, you know, you're sitting at a stoplight and you can tell the kids, do you guys see any yellow signs? And the kid can point out a yellow sign. Now, whether it's a restaurant sign that we may all know, or it's something else, they know, they can,
the colors
it helps,
there.
But it helps make that connection of learning colors, learning letters, learning how to count. My kid's daycare, his class is on the second level. And so when we go through the door and we're about to go up the steps, I ask him, do you want to count in Spanish or English?
Excellent.
And so he'll say, you know, Spanish or English, and we'll count. There's 20 steps, so I'll count the first 10. Uno, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco, seis, siete, ocho, nueve, diez. And then he'll count the second. And he does it by himself in Spanish.
Good tips.
But those are things that, right. Regardless of what language you speak, or if you don't speak any other languages, most people can learn how to count to 10 in Spanish, or maybe just 5. You can do that with your kids.
And your grandchildren.
And your grandchildren, or the children that you're taking care of, if right. you're a child care provider or a caregiver, it's the possibilities are endless.
What about tips, and those were excellent, but, you know, there's a dilemma, I think, as a parent. You want your child to watch good programming, but you don't want excessive television on a general basis. How do you find that balance? What is the balance?
Oh, that's a tough one. Yeah, as a parent, that is something that we're facing, especially now with on-demand and our kids.
So much, yes.
Absolutely. Our kids wanting to watch what they want to watch when they want to watch it. And there's a good side to that, but there's the downside to that as well. And it is, as you said, it's finding that balance. Something that I do with my kids is, you know, we do everything in moderation. And so it's not necessarily that I use it as a reward. It's definitely not, well, if you eat your dinner, then you can. But it is, this is what we're gonna do. And I sit down with my kids in the morning, we wake up, get dressed for the day, we have our breakfast, and while we're sitting down at the table, if it's a Saturday or whatever, I will actually give them what their schedule is going to be for the first half of the day. All right, guys, after we're done eating breakfast, we're going to go outside and we're going to play for a little bit, and then when we come inside, we can watch, in Spanish I say un poco de, right, a little bit of Curious George or a little bit of Dinosaur Train or whatever the case is, and then it'll be lunchtime, and I'll say, do you understand? Yes, deal, thumbs up. They give me a thumbs up if they get it. And now they know.
And that works.
Now they know that after we play, we can watch a little bit of TV, and then it'll be lunchtime, and then it'll be nap time. So they understand that they're going to be able to watch it. It's just not going to be an all-day thing.
And it's a
so
structure for them as well.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You know, when I was growing up, I remember the children's programming seemed silly. The clowns, cartoons, science was very dry. How important is it to blend that fun learning element all together? It looks so much better nowadays.
I know exactly what you're talking about because as we were discussing earlier, I'm the same age. I'm a little older than your children. So I grew up watching the programming that you're referring to. That to me, that is my motto. My motto is have fun with the kids and make them forget that they're learning. Kids are going to do They're great at mimicking and following and absorbing. And if you can lead them in having fun, then they're gonna completely forget that they're learning. You know, when I do my story times during my live performances, I introduce words that are in Spanish, but they don't realize that they're learning something new. They're learning a different language for those that don't speak Spanish. Because we're having fun going on an adventure and learning about animals or reading a story about Curious George. They don't realize that they're learning. And then when they realize that they learned, it was like, hey, that wasn't that bad. Let's keep doing it. Let's do it again. So to me, it's we as adults know that there's education first, fun second, but you present it. It's sort of that reverse psychology. Have fun first, and then you have them to learn.
And that works. And you have a very natural way of weaving English and Spanish together. How do you do that? And as you say, a little bit more about why it's so important, why you feel it's so important.
I think learning in general is an amazing thing, and it's something that we can all do regardless of age, regardless of socioeconomic status, regardless of background or experience. We can always learn something new. And so the opportunity to learn a different language, be it Spanish or be it another language, Italian, German, French, Greek, it doesn't matter. It's the idea of learning something different and expanding your mindset to a different world that exists. Being able to learn two languages at any age is difficult, but being able to do it at a young age, I find it really helps. There's something that happens with this balancing act that now the brain has to do, because it's thinking in two different languages at the very same time.
And that's what you emphasize.
Absolutely.
And it comes out so smoothly.
Absolutely. When I introduce, another game that I play is Miss Rosa Says. And so I introduce body parts. Miss Rosa Says, put your hands on your head. In Spanish, cabeza. And the kids learn that it's cabeza. Then we go to a different body part. Well, by the end of the game, they've learned five different body parts, how to say them in Spanish and in English. And it's a great way for the younger kids that can't read yet to make the connection, because it's visual, so they don't have to learn how to read. It's a great challenge for the older kids because they can read the words and they're learning how to actually say something in Spanish, and they're seeing what the word is, what it looks like.
And they'll remember that.
And they'll remember that because you're making that instant connection. It's head, cabeza. It's no different than learning your social security number, because it's a rhythmic pattern, right? We always learn numbers, our area code and our phone number. It's area code, first three numbers, last four numbers. And there's a rhythm to it. And so I think that I have found that does help with learning both.
Do you have any suggestions, again, for parents as they try to navigate the technology that's coming along and adjust to the new ways that we're educating children? Any suggestions?
I do have some suggestions, and I would say that it's sort of a twofold. The first part is embrace the amount of amazing resources that are now available for parents. In every regard, whether it be an app that you can have on your phone, whether it be the on-demand programming that's available. PBS Kids website is amazing with all of programming and learning activities that the kids can do. It's also an amazing place for parents to find additional resources for them. It gives suggestions on some of the different games that I talked about that they can do at home, things that they can do to have that full circle viewership, that co-parenting, that co-viewership experience for them. So embrace all of these awesome resources, I keep saying
that. Or they're tools, actually.
Absolutely, they're tools. They're absolutely tools. I mean, it's, when I became a parent, the joke was, kids don't come with manuals. Now they kind of do. I mean, not exactly your child, but we can find there's so many people that want us as young parents to succeed. So why try to reinvent the wheel? Why not just go to those resources, access all of the wealth of information that's available to you, and help your child become the best person that they can, the best adult that they can be. On the flip side, be aware of what you're using. It is our job as parents and adults to monitor what it is that we're exposing our kids to, and make sure that it's lining up with what it is that you want your kid to learn. At the end of the day, we want our kids to have fun, and we know that they're going to learn no matter what, regardless of whether or not we should. Kids are just naturally, it's the natural evolution of growing up. That's just what we do. So make sure that you're aware of what it is that they're absorbing, because that will definitely make a difference later on. Absolutely.
Right. Thank you so much. You've given me many tips for my grandchildren as well.
You're welcome.
When we come back, we'll talk about how early childhood education issues are being addressed right here in Central Florida. Joining us now is Karen Willis, the CEO of Early Learning Coalition of Orange County. Karen, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me. I really appreciate it.
About the coalition.
Yes.
What is the mission, and can you tell us a little bit about who your partners are?
Sure. The mission of the coalition is to help children in our community be ready for school. We work primarily with children between the ages of birth to five, but a lot of the work that we're trying to do is to make sure that they're ready for school, but that they also meet that critical next step, which is reading at third grade. Our partners are really very diverse. We have a board that's composed of business leaders as well as community folks from all facets of our community. But we work in partnership with the Healthy Start Coalition, with Healthy Families, the Beta Center, Coalition for the Homeless, the domestic violence shelters here in town. So really we work with anybody and everybody in the community that's really trying to help our very, very young children
be successful. So you have both the public and private sectors as partnerships.
Absolutely.
With that. With the focus on kindergarten and pre-K programs, at least I seem to hear a lot mm-hmm. about that, that period of time from birth to 3 years, are we missing critical opportunities there?
Really, we are, because in the first 3 years of a child's life, 85% of the brain architecture is already developed. By age five, it's 90%. So in those first 3 years, absolutely critical that we are providing the support, the caring, the love, the interaction with children in order for their brain to develop as it needs to.
How critical would you say is parental involvement in early childhood development?
Absolutely. Children learn from their parents. Their parents are their first and best teacher. They're the ones that help that child feel safe in the world. They're the ones that help that child begin to develop language. Every part of who we are as human beings is linked to the relationship we have with our parents.
That with the coalition, the services, are they centered around the child and the academic world, or do you have more of a broader perspective?
Well, let's think about it with the people that you work with. Who is it that you like to work with? Generally, it's those people who have a balance of relationship skills. They know how to interact with other people, and people who also have the technical skills, so they know how to do their job. That's exactly what it is in the work that we do. There is a balance of how do we help children develop the social emotional skills that help them feel good about themselves and help them feel good about their interactions with other folks, as well as how to develop those cognitive skills that are part of the language development that we all need to be able to again hit that really important milestone of reading at third grade.
I heard you say in another interview, you talked about the social, the emotional, academic, and you also added in resiliency skills.
Absolutely.
How critical those pieces are to fit together. So you're looking at really the whole atmosphere of what goes into being a successful and productive person as you age.
Absolutely. We all have to be able to stick to it. We're all going to run into challenges in our lives. And if we aren't resilient enough to be able to step back and say, okay, that may not have worked, but let's go at it again, we're not going to be successful as adults.
I've also heard you say, you use the term of we need to invest in our children. What do you mean by that?
Investing in our kids is really the same thing that we would do when we're building a building downtown. We're making an investment that we think is going to pay off in the future. When we're working with very young children, we're building that architecture of the brain that serves as the foundation for everything else that's going to happen later. So when we make an investment in the first 5 years of a child's life, what happens during that period of time is really going to impact what happens in the next 85 years of a person's life. So that's what we mean by investing. Make sure that the architecture is there, make sure the foundation is there that is going to help a person be successful for the rest of their lives. Help them be able to be a contributing member of our society, not only as a worker, but also as a parent in the future, as a grandparent in the future, because we, you know, we have a long life to live, and we want to make sure that what happens in those first 5 years is really, really beneficial to our kids.
So you're actually saying then you're taking a short-term approach for the early childhood, but there's much more of a long-term strategy involved here.
Absolutely. If you look at some of the research, it will tell you that children who have been involved in high-quality early learning programs, the first research that came out looked at these children 21 years later and found that the return on investment for every dollar that was spent to help these children be ready for school, there was a $7 return because these kids were working, they were not on welfare, they were not having to take remedial classes, they were not unemployed. So it is a benefit to our community to make sure that we're making the investments that are going to pay off for our kids in the future.
We know already that lack of stimulation and early childhood impedes development. What are some of the other challenges that also impair that progress?
Abuse and neglect, poor nutrition, poor health care. Neuro scanning actually shows that children who are abused and neglected, their brain is developed differently than children who are not abused and neglected. So our community partners are really important to us to make sure that if there's intervention that needs to happen with young children or their families, that that intervention comes as early as possible so that we're able to, again, help that brain architecture build the way that it needs to build.
Karen, when you look at those kinds of services with Central Florida and Orange County, how necessary, how needed are those services for right here for our children?
Well, I can tell you that the coalition has over 7,000 children on our subsidized child care wait list.
On a wait list.
62% of those children are under the age of five. Over 1,200 of those children are under the age of three. So we know that we have a real need in this community to expand the ability to offer high quality programs to children, particularly our low income children, who benefit the most when they have a stimulating environment, when we're able to partner with their parents to give those kids additional experiences that they might not otherwise get if they were not able to be helped in some way through a good program.
So you have a combination of funding, a state and federal? And the private sector as
and
well.
And the private sector as well. The coalition needs to raise about $1.5 million a year to bring down all of the money that's available to us through the state and federal funding that we have. We do that through a variety of different ways. Donations are wonderful. We write a lot of grants. We just came off of our gala where we raised almost $90,000. That gets matched $15.67 for every dollar we raise locally.
So that's a good match.
That's very exciting. We have our State of Early Care and Education event that's coming up in October. That's an opportunity for people to contribute as well. So
that's how our viewers can get involved then.
Absolutely.
Through supporting with the gala. Any other suggestions for them?
Books. We are very fortunate that we are the recipient of the Baskets for Books with the Orlando Magic in conjunction with the Blue Foundation and Heart Court. But we need more books. We have children in our community that do not have books in their home. It's hard to have someone read to you if you do not have books in your home. So books are something that we really encourage your viewers to supply. Books that are appropriate for children birth to five. Other ways that folks can get involved are very, very simple things. We stand in line all the time, and generally there are children in front of us or in back of us. Talk to kids. Just talk to kids. It's so exciting to be able to do that. Very simple ways.
Very good. Thank you, Karen, so much for your time today.
We really appreciate the opportunity.
That's all the time we have for our show today. Please visit WUCFTV.org/metro for interactive features, special content, and much more. Thanks for joining us. Until next time, I'm Diane Treese.